this promoting, is it possible to at the same time have multiple connections to an exchange server?
Yeah, you can have as many sessions open as you want. So, get PS session. I've got one open. Have as many as you want. There are certain customer environments where I go to that I'll have my own profile on their domain. And when I log on and I start PowerShell, I have a profile script that will automatically set up connections to the 10 computers I know I'm going to have to mess with. Or I'll write little scripts, batch files really. I need to do something to all the web servers. So create connections to all of those, and then I'll use them, and then I can just close them down when I'm done. So the only limit is memory, right? By keeping this session open, I've got a copy of PowerShell running on the remote computer, which is, it's fairly tiny. And I've got a thread of PowerShell running on my computer. So every session I have is basically another copy of PowerShell on my computer that's up and running, kinda. I mean, it's not quite that much overhead, and even that's not that much. So, if your admin workstation has only got like a gig of RAM, you might want to quit your job. Somebody, I forget where I was, said that they had no problem getting a 32 gig admin machine. Wow. Like, where do I send my resume?
When tying this to earlier in your talk, when you were showing the, you were talking about troubleshooting a remote connection. Are you still going to see
Yeah, so for troubleshooting, everything I said for troubleshooting still applies. So what happens normally when you just run like enter PS session or invoke command and give it a computer name, it creates this session, does your dirty work, and then closes the session. All I've done is create a session that can be reused, but it's the exact same technology, exact same troubleshooting. You would do a trace and you look in the same log.
And if you're doing a trace, is that only
That particular PS Diagnostics module is only about remoting. That's what it's designed to trace.
But if you were to remote to a third-party product?
It doesn't matter. It's covering remoting at the low level. Think of it as like a packet sniffer.
So it's really just a tick. It's breaking it at that level.
Yeah, it's way below anybody's technology. What else we got?
I had a question about remoting with or background jobs, rather.
Background jobs.
Yeah,
background jobs are fun. So, let's say I run invoke command, and I kick off a command that's going to run against, I don't know, how many servers do you have? How many servers you guys got?
480.
480? That's a very precise number.
42.
42, okay. Sitting and watching that run could take some time, depending on what command I was running. So with invoke command, as well as a couple other commands, you have an as job parameter somewhere. This help makes my eyes cross. Yeah, there it is. Right here. What that does is it creates that job on a background thread, essentially a separate PowerShell process. So every job you've got running is going to be a separate PowerShell process, which means a little bit more processor on your computer, a little bit more memory on your computer. It runs in the background, so looks something like this. Get event log security newest 1000. As job on computer, whatever. I immediately get my shell back, I can start doing other stuff, and this just runs in the background. I can periodically check in with it. Oh, look, it's done. Let's receive those results. So you can start a job locally using start job. Let's see, get command noun job. You can use start job to start a local job, right? One that's just consuming local resources. Invoke command can run a job on multiple, against multiple remote computers. And get WMI object has an as job parameter as well. And so if you have a WMI call that's hitting multiple computers, normally those go sequentially. But you can parallelize it by running it as a job, and it'll talk to up to 32 of them at once by default. Again, every one of those is a little copy of PowerShell running on your computer, so memory, processor constraints, everything else, but 32 seems to work well for most people. And then once you've got the job running, you can do whatever. Here's the trick. Even though getWMIObject does not use PowerShell remoting, and even though startJob creates a local job, you can only use the job system if remoting is enabled on that machine. Because under the hood, the job mechanism utilizes the remoting technology. So if I don't have remoting enabled, no jobs. Is that what you were going
to
ask?
I was going to ask if you started those jobs and they're running on the other machine, if you close your shell and try to reopen it.
Oh, yeah, that's a good one. So here's the scenario. I used to do this a lot before I figured out what was going on. Computer A, computer B. I send a command. I use invoke a command to tell computer B to start a job. Computer B starts the job, immediately gets the shell prompt back because now the job's running. That tells remoting that everything's finished. And so it kills that PowerShell process and tells me, I'm done. And you lost your job. Your job's no longer running. You have no way to get whatever results it may have produced. So you're almost never going to use remoting to start a job on a remote computer unless you're doing it with a session, because a session leaves this copy of PowerShell up and running. So if you have to do that, that's how you do it. Awesome questions. What else?
Yeah, so we had another one in the chat room about wondering if you can describe or explain the double up issue with remoting.
Yeah. Oh, yes, yes. I can do what? Oh, it sort of works. Not really.
Okay.
Work on that. So here's the double hop issue. I'm on computer A. That's me. I remote over to computer B. So now I've got a shell prompt on computer B. I tell computer B to access some network resource, which is on computer C, like a folder or a file or a user or a group or whatever. By default, the remoting system uses the Kerberos protocol. That's the only thing that's turned on by default. It does that for a number of reasons. First of all, it's the native authentication protocol in a domain. Is everybody using Active Directory? Have we gotten there? Okay, good. No netware? Awesome. So when I go from computer A to B, we mutually authenticate each other. I know that I'm talking to computer B, and it knows who I am. And my credential passes across the network in the form of a Kerberos ticket. Not my password, nothing scary. It's a Kerberos ticket. Computer B is allowed to use that ticket to accomplish whatever I tell it to do. So it's running commands under my credential, not local system or network service or some crazy other thing. Kerberos by default only allows that delegation to happen over one hop, right? A to B, one hop. When computer B needs to access something on computer C, it's not allowed to pass my credential along. And because the service isn't running under an all-powerful account, it basically has no permissions anyplace. Without my credential, it's useless. And so it can't access anything off of computer B because there's no credential really to go with it. And there's a couple of ways you can get around this. One involves enabling an alternative authentication protocol called CredSSP and making some configuration changes to Kerberos in your domain so you can allow multiple hops. If you hop on your favorite search engine, you can search for PowerShell remoting second hop, and there's a couple of big discussions on it on server fault, and people have laid out the directions. I mean, there's a number of steps you have to take, but it's reasonably well documented out there. You're the only one. Go ahead. Yeah.
As scripts, I'm guessing this is more of an opinion question.
I have lots of opinions. Those are free.
As scripts get larger, what are some ways that you look at making simplifying troubleshooting later, or
great question. So as your scripts get bigger and more complicated and they're doing more, how do you keep it easier to maintain, basically? The right way to do anything in PowerShell is to put it in a function, preferably what PowerShell calls an advanced function, or what the rest of us call a script commandlet. Each commandlet or function should only do one thing. It should either retrieve information and put it in the pipeline, or act against information that it has been given from the pipeline, or something else, but just one thing. You never want a function that's going to read computer names and reboot them all. That's two steps. One function to read computer names, the second function reboots them all, and the third function formats the output or whatever else. So keeping things really, really tightly modular, and then your script just calls those in whatever order they need to be called. You get a lot of reusability that way. You get better use of PowerShell's built-in commands that way. And then you can modularize those, so take libraries of those or collections of those, and make them into modules that can be easily loaded and unloaded and distributed, put into source control, and all the good things that we ought to do with, you know, mission-critical processes. So rather than having a 600-line straight-up script, break each piece down and then just have some one-liners that call those pieces. And that way, each individual unit of work is usually much simpler and easier to deal with if it breaks.
Is there any way to have functions not at the beginning of the script?
Is there any way to have functions not at the beginning of the script? No. No. Basically, a PowerShell, so you're thinking like VBScript where you could stack them all at the end? Yeah, the VBScript parser did a read ahead. Right, it would read through your entire script and it would make a note of certain things like functions, and then it would start executing them. PowerShell doesn't do that. It goes line by line. And so if it hasn't seen the function, it doesn't know about it. I try to never have a script that includes functions and standalone code. I want all my functions in one library, and I will import that from within a second script and call those functions there. Just from a kind of clutter standpoint, that's just me.
Is that in your, doing things that way in your book?
I do proselytize that in the book, yes.
Nice.
It's in chapter 20-something. 22? 22 seems valid. Right before debugging.
So is there a point where, okay, so you have a task, it does one thing, that becomes a function.
Yep.
If you've got a bunch of functions now, you are putting that into a
module. Yeah, a bunch of functions go into a module. And a module is a file.
So any guidelines or anything that you see people doing things that you may think are not optimal in the way that they created modules?
No. I mean, modules are pretty simple. It's just a file with a bunch of functions in it. Not a big deal. I see people make mistakes with functions all the time, though. If you're using right host, you're going to hell. I'm sorry, but you are. I don't make the rules. I just enforce them. Any time a function is outputting formatted text, right? You're making your own tables, using tab characters, whatever else, you're doing it totally wrong. Don't do that. PowerShell hates text, doesn't want to deal with text, doesn't want you to deal with text. Stop it with the text already. It's not Perl. If you like text, get Perl. That's the biggest one. You can see a lot of those. You guys know the scripting games?
Yeah.
Scripting wife is on the remote tonight. Hi, Teresa.
Yeah, everybody say hi to scripting wife. Hi, scripting wife.
Ed Wilson listening too, the scripting guy.
Oh, is he?
Probably.
Hey, Ed. So one of the biggest things, I don't know if you know this or not, but when you type a command, instead of asking for help, you can do minus question, right? And they kind of hacked that in because that's how a lot of us are used to asking for help with a command line utility, and it still works. So in the scripting games, I'll almost always see people, because he'll award style points if you add built-in help, and I'll see people use right host, and at the top of their script, They'll check to see if it was run with minus question, and then there's 800 million write hosts that create this exact kind of format. Nope, wrong. If you're using write host, you are probably doing it wrong. There's a feature called comment-based help, where you would embed that information in comments with special keywords. PowerShell parses that out and constructs this nicely formatted thing. You can read all about it in my book. about comment-based help. So if June Blender is in, I get like a drink every time I plug this. So, but yeah, all this is a special kind. And you were going to put comments in your scripts anyway, right, to document what they do and who wrote it, maybe provide some examples. Well, if you just do it with a couple extra keywords, PowerShell can tear that apart and create a formatted help screen for you. You should not ever be formatting text for pretty much any reason ever. If you are, you are definitely doing it wrong.
So the text that is in this formatted text, that is just going to be in there. But
yeah.
If you're using the keywords, that will take care of the formatting.
Yeah, if you use the keyword, it'll take care of the formatting. So that's the big thing I see people doing wrong with functions. Either that or trying to pack too much in. You know, and again, break it out. If you're doing multiple units of work, make them multiple commands. More reusable that way, more flexible.
Can we invoke these commands using C-sharp or something like
that? Can you invoke these commands from C-sharp? Yeah, totally. So the deal with PowerShell is, here, I'll show you. I'll show you the deal with PowerShell. Oops. This is PowerShell.exe. And I point that out because it is 473 kilobytes. Who thinks that PowerShell is really 473 kilobytes? Not. That's just the console app. That's the blue screen I'm interacting with. PowerShell is a gigantic .NET framework class. This instantiates it. Within C#, you can just instantiate that class directly. So you download the Windows SDK. That gives you the reference assemblies you need to reflect against in Visual Studio. Add a reference to those to your project. And then you get IntelliSense and everything else. You instantiate the engine, create a run space, create a pipeline, shove commands in its throat, it runs it, you get objects back. You do whatever you want. Make them into GUI icons, print them out, sacrifice goats, doesn't matter. So that's how the Exchange team wrote the Exchange Management Console. When you start clicking stuff in the EMC, behind the scenes, they've loaded up PowerShell that way, and they're telling it commands, and then they get the results back and construct tree views and graphs and grids and all that garbage. So yeah, a C-sharp or a VB developer, anybody in .NET can get to PowerShell super easy.
Chat room question, looking for an example or explanation on splatting.
Splatting. Okay, I can do that.
Nice. What is splatting?
Yeah, I'm going to see. You don't have the ISE on here, I don't think, so this will just be exciting.
You can put it on real quick.
No, it'll take too long. We'll use Notepad.
Nice.
Now I'm going to go to hell. I always tell people not to use Notepad. So splatting is a Unix term. It's kind of easier to show it to you. Let's say I've got a command, get WMyObject. Class Win32 BIOS, and I'm just going to I'm going to format this rather than typing it all like for real so we can kind of read it together. Here, lots of real estate. Computer name, whatever. Filter. Actually, I don't know anything that I would filter for there. Let's do logical disk. Drive type equals 3. That's one way you can run a command in PowerShell. Now, I could actually make this legitimately execute by putting an escape character at the end of these lines. So I'm escaping the carriage return so that PowerShell will read the subsequent line as part of that one. That is ugly and really hard to read, and when you put it into a book, people think that the backtick character is just an extra bit of toner that snuck in, and they don't type it, and so the command doesn't work. So, no me gusta. Splatting is kind of a way to take a bunch of parameters and make them a little neater. The way you do it is something like this. Parameters equals, and then you create a hash table. And the keys for the hash table are your parameter names. class equals Win32 logical disk, semicolon. PowerShell knows when it sees a semicolon that there's got to be something coming next, and so we will automatically scan the next line to continue it. You don't have to put a line continuation character or any goofy stuff like that. Computer name equals whatever. Filter equals drive type equals 3. So now I've put all my parameters into this hash table. Get WMyObject splat parms. And this is the stuff that'll kind of get people. In PowerShell, a variable name does not include the dollar sign. The dollar sign is just a parser cue that what follows is a variable name. A dollar sign tells PowerShell to resolve the variable into its contents. So here I'm saying I want to change the contents of parms. Here I'm using at as a splat operator, and you just give it the variable name. If you do at dollar parms, it won't work. And that's what can kind of mess you up with the syntax a little bit. A lot of people will do this in scripts, especially when you start looking at commands like new AD user or some of the SharePoint commands or some of the Exchange commands that have 50, 11 dozen billion parameters. Rather than having one command that stretches off into infinity and you have to horizontally scroll forever, you can kind of break them down real nicely. And because of the way PowerShell treats that semicolon, you can have them exactly like this in your script file, and it will read all of that as one command, one line. So it looks a little pretty. It's a little bit more human readable. And that's one of the reasons people like it. So it is a neat little trick. You're starting to see people do it a little bit more now, I think, than when it first came out, because Word is starting to get out. I don't think there's a help file for it, though. Help splat. Yeah, see, that's not good. Whenever it does that, it's doing a full text search. It doesn't find anything. Well, you could Google splat. That's how I always have to remind myself. PowerShell splat, and then I have to look it up. Could I have used a semicolon in the first example? No. Because normally, outside of this hash table construct, normally a semicolon means end of command, new command to follow. Just like it does in most of the C-flavored languages, right? It only allows me to do this inside of those curly brackets because it's part of the hash table construct. My biggest beef with PowerShell, honestly, is that every single piece of punctuation is used in three different and completely non-intuitive ways. The chapter that took me the longest to write was, I think, chapter 28, the PowerShell cheat sheet, which has four pages that explain what all the punctuation does. It was a very rewarding week.
So Don, I got a question for you about profiles. More of a philosophical question than a technical question necessarily. The environment I'm in would probably have 1,000 servers just in the Americas and distributed administration for those. What is the value of having a common profile across all of those servers?
Yikes. So I gotta admit that because I don't work day-to-day in a production environment, I probably have a kind of limited view on profiles. My use for profiles is to preload stuff that I do frequently. Like, I always want the Active Directory module loaded, and I don't want to ask any questions. So that goes in my profile. Change the error text to green. Change to the root of my C drive, because I hate starting out in my profile root. And that's honestly about the limit of it. So for me, that's something I would want to happen no matter what machine I'm on. But that's probably about it.
Okay. Part of the reason I'm asking the question is the environment I come from is a fairly substantial Linux environment. And we do have the ability to very easily create a common login environment because your login home directory is a network directory. So if one, when I log in, I get the same profile everywhere I go as long as I'm in that environment. And trying to duplicate that with PowerShells and with Windows in general is non-trivial.
Yeah. I don't know that I would care. I mean, honestly, when I go to most customers that I work with, I don't have profiles. And so anytime the shell opens, I almost just out of habit kind of run three commands while I'm still waiting for the shell to load in my head. I'm changing to the C directory and blah, blah, blah. It kind of depends on what's in your profile and how much you need it. If it's something you need everywhere and it's a hassle to get going, well, then it could be worth having it in a profile.
Is it worth having one of the other parts of this? I haven't worked enough with remoting to know for sure how this works, but do I need that profile if I'm using remoting?
Remoting does not use profiles.
Does not load.
When you engage a remoting session, the remote computer will not scan or load profiles.
And there's no option to do so.
No, you would have to make a custom run space that did that, because it's the run space that is programmed to go look for these files.
That answers my question.
Ladies and gentlemen, let me just take a quick thing. We're going to take a quick break here in a moment. We also want to do some giveaways tonight. Also, I want to let the remotes to know you can have your microphones turned on so you can ask Don questions at any time as well. If you just let Mr. Pfeiffer know about it through chatting, he'll turn your mic on and you can ask questions. Guys, why don't we take 10 and do some giveaways and stuff like that, and then we can go back to talking to Don and asking questions and stuff. Yeah?
Yeah.
And I'm going to, actually, right before we do that, because there's some folks who are remote, I'm going to write a URL up here, because some folks asked about it earlier. concentratedtech.com/buy. If anybody does want to purchase an autographed book, I have 5 of them with me that I can sell. I have 1 I'm going to give away. You can also get it from there. If you want to purchase it tonight, it's $5 in shipping. If you go to the website, I would recommend you wait about a week, because we just got our shipping discounted by the post office. So the website is still charging, I think, $15 for shipping. So it'll be $10 cheaper if you wait till I get home and I upload the new page. And we'll ship it anywhere in the U.S. If you're international, definitely wait until next week, because international shipping is only going to be $15, which isn't bad for a book, I think. So keep that in mind. I do have 1 other DVD that we're going to give away, which is my Go Pack, and we don't sell these anymore, really. It's all PowerShell video training, including a complete 1-day workshop that I did for a conference. It's a recording from the entire workshop, my voice and whatever was on my screen, slides, everything. So that's all on here. And I'll have that to, you guys can raffle off as well. So,
cool. Your worst. Thanks in, folks. Bye.